Well, I think that was the message. We can all go home now. The gospel message today comes from the book of John, the newest of our gospels, and John's message is one of love for the most part. So please listen now for the word of the Lord. We're in John 20, 19 through 31. Hold on a minute. Technology is lovely when it works. Okay. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for the fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they retain them." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the marks of the nails on his hands, or put my fingers in the marks of the nails, or my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it on my side. Do you not doubt but believe?" Thomas answered, "My Lord, my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen? Blessed are those who have not seen, yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which was not written in the book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. You know, every time I read this scripture, I just think, poor Thomas. Poor Thomas. I mean, think about it for a minute. Thomas has been labeled by pretty much everybody since the beginning of our tradition, since the beginning of Christianity. Thomas has been labeled Doubting Thomas. And having doubts is not really seen as a fruit of the Spirit, right? We don't mark it up there with kindness or generosity. We don't mark it up with our truthfulness, right? Honesty. It's not really something we aspire to be, doubting. But here's Thomas. He's been labeled Doubting Thomas. And we've placed him in the disciple hierarchy somewhere barely just above Judas, right? In our tradition. And just below those disciples who we can't remember their names, right? Like Thaddeus and Bartholomew, or old what's-his-name. There are tons of videos and children's stories and messages written to kids about believing. And they always use Thomas as an example. Don't be like Thomas, guys. Just believe. Don't have doubts. Just believe. Know that God saved you. Know that Jesus Christ is your Lord. Don't be like Doubting Thomas. I kind of feel bad for the guy, right? Centuries of shaming? He has endured a lot at this point. I think part of the reason this happens is because we read this part of John without reading the previous part of John. So I'm going to go back just a little bit from what I didn't read to you, and I want to talk about verse 18, where Mary Magdalene goes to the disciples straight from her conversation with the risen Christ and says to them, "I have seen the Lord." A woman standing there amongst these men proclaiming the risen Lord. Yet, after she says that to them, by that evening, we find all of them locked in a room, huddled together in fear. So let me get this straight. They didn't believe her. They hid themselves away, except for Thomas. Where was Thomas? Yeah, Thomas wasn't huddled in that room with them when Jesus came. Where was Thomas? He wasn't hiding in fear with the other disciples that day. I'm sure we can think of a lot of reasons or speculate where Thomas was. I mean, perhaps there were, somebody had to go get food, so they played rock, paper, scissors, and Thomas lost. Right? Or perhaps Thomas was volunteered to leave and go do something that needed to do, because I'm guessing a room that is hot got pretty smelly with a bunch of men in it for days on time. Maybe Thomas wanted out, much like I want out of my seventh period class full of adolescent boys who just came from PE. Right? I could speculate all day. But the truth remains that Thomas was not hiding in the room when Jesus came. He was not there. They were there and he was not. And suddenly in that locked room without Thomas, it had been infiltrated with someone saying, "Peace be with you," and then nothing. Then Jesus shows up with his hands in his side, and then the disciples rejoice, for they get it now, for they have seen the Lord. But I feel like we forget this moment when we talk about Thomas. Because did the disciples believe? Were they going out, or were they hiding in a room before they saw Jesus? Because scripture tells us they were hiding in fear, huddled together. But we always forget that when we want to talk about Thomas. The moment when the other disciples were equally unbelieving until they saw for themselves. And I think that moment defines the story. I really do. Jesus breathes on them and gives them the Holy Spirit and a commission. A commission. He sends them out. He says, "Witness to others, share with your words. Make sure your lives are a testament to God." That's basically what he says to them. And when Thomas returns from who knows where, he finds the disciples still locked in that room, still hiding in fear. And they say the same thing to Thomas that Mary Magdalene had already said. "We have seen the Lord." Yet Thomas doesn't trust their testimony any more than he had trusted Mary's. Why should he? They're still hiding. They're still hiding. They can tell what they want, but their actions proclaim a different story. They can say, "We've seen him. Christ has risen. Everything that was said to us is true." But they're hiding in a room. Why would Thomas believe them? Because their actions spoke a lot louder than their words, pretty much across the board. So Thomas says what anyone would say: "I'm not going to believe until I see it with my own eyes. You say you've saw it, but I want that too. I want what you're having. I want what she's having. I want what he has. I want to see it too." Why you? Why Mary Magdalene? What about me? All Thomas wants is that personal close-up experience that the other disciples have had, but Thomas missed out on. Don't we often do the same sometimes? I do. Maybe you don't, but I do. Sometimes it's easy for us to look at our own lives and the lives of our neighbors, and the lives of people that we only keep up with on Facebook or through messages in some way, and say, "Oh man, their lives look perfect. They look like they have it all. They look like they've seen Jesus. I want that too." Sometimes we look at that church down the street and we want what they have. We want what they have, yet for voicing that desire for what others have, we have painted Thomas with this doubter's brush, right? And we look down on him for his unbelief. Well, at least the other disciples did. Maybe you don't. But I have to wonder, why do we feel the need to do that? Is it so easy to forget the rest of the story? And instead of insisting on looking at Thomas as somehow he was beneath us because he doubted, think of him as our equal, as on the same playing field as the disciples, afraid and scared and huddled in a room and unsure of what is next. Jesus says to Thomas, "Do you not believe? Do you believe because you saw, or because you actually believe? Blessed are those who have not seen yet come to believe." I don't read this as a condemnation of Thomas, but maybe as a condemnation of the whole community, because you have to remember, when Jesus comes back and Thomas does finally see his hands and his side, the disciples are still hiding in that room. So maybe it's a message to the whole community, because you know they were listening. Why are you still here? Why are you not out there? Why are you not spreading the message and the commission that I gave to you? You're not convincing anyone locked in this room. Maybe Jesus is saying to all of them that there's a blessing on those who are part of the community that does witness to the risen Christ in both word and action. Maybe Christ, in a way, is speaking to us. One of my favorite pastors says that the shaming of Thomas comes from two main sources. One is our understanding of the word believe, and the other is our sense of own fear and shame about not being 100% certain of things ourselves, about our own doubts. First, we tend to think that believing is something that we do wholeheartedly, right? If we believe in God's message, if we believe about the grace that we have received in Jesus Christ, if we believe the story of the resurrection, then we have to take it all. And we can't pick it apart, and we can't have questions, and we can't have doubts. And if we do, we somehow are less than we should be. But I think that's a slippery slope, because I think for Christ, belief was something else. To believe in God, to believe God, is to trust God with all of our hearts, which is not quite the same as not having questions. To believe with all of our soul, our mind, and our strength, to place our trust, to commit our lives. And I think this is what the gospel writers were trying to get us to do. So I think it's okay for Thomas to have doubts. I think Thomas can still believe and ask questions. I actually think that our questions help grow our belief. And when someone we trust and love answers them and is willing to mess with it and move it and manipulate it in a way that we try to understand God's message, then we grow deeper in our faith. I think doubts like Thomas's are helpful and necessary on a journey of faith. So belief doesn't mean that you understand, that you know everything, that you're certain in everything you do and every belief you have. Belief is a journey, one that requires us to question and think, to speculate, to doubt, a little bit like Thomas. And the other thing is our shame. You know, through Christian centuries, Thomas has been looked down for lots of reasons, but mostly because he doubted, because somehow doubting is bad. It's bad. It means that you don't fully believe, that you don't fully have faith for a lot of these communities. And so here are people who can look down on Thomas because they know in their hearts that they also have questions. And it is easier to make a scapegoat or push someone down than reflect on your own self. Faith includes doubts and questions, but we've locked away ours, right? We lock them away. When Thomas shows up voicing them, the only thing we can do is act out of our own shame and ridicule him, so no one will know what is hiding inside of us. No one will know that we have questions. But Jesus comes right through that locked, broken door, both that day and both in our hearts. Breaks through that locked door, and no matter where we're hiding, Jesus steps in and gives us peace. He gives Thomas exactly what he needs to trust. Exactly what Thomas needed in that moment. Thomas needed to see his hands. He needed to feel his side. And in the process, he shows the other disciples yet again, one more time, because they also needed to see him one more time. what it means to make God visible. To meet people where they are, to love them fully, to understand that we don't all get to the same place on the same path. The disciples were still hiding and they needed to see Jesus again. And sometimes we hide too, and we need to see Jesus in some way so that we can too get the courage to step out in faith. Sometimes we have to have a little sighting here and there. And it works. Jesus coming once again and showing Thomas and the disciples, it works. And Thomas doesn't rejoice at what he's seen, which is what we'd probably expect. Oh, finally, I get it. Thank you. They were making fun of me for a week. No, that's not what he says. He says, my Lord and my God. Can you imagine the relief of anxiety that Thomas felt at that one moment? Where he had heard from Mary and he had heard from the disciples, yet his brain and his mournfulness had blocked his vision of the risen Lord. And he couldn't feel or hear Jesus because he was surrounded by sorrow. And so there is Jesus standing before him, and instead of rejoicing in what he finally knows, he says, my Lord, my God. What would it take for us to have trust like that? What do we need in order to have faith rather than certainty? Because faith isn't certainty. It isn't having all the answers. For a moment, a small moment, what do you need in order to trust God completely? Thomas needed to see Jesus. The disciples needed to see Jesus twice, and they needed to hear from Mary Magdalene. But we might need something too in order to trust fully. We might need something too, and we might have doubts that we aren't willing to voice because we're afraid of the shame and ridicule that comes with voicing them. Maybe we need to see new life. Maybe we need a burning bush. Maybe we need a healing or a smile from a stranger. Maybe we need a glimmer of hope when all seems lost. Maybe we just need a note from a friend or the right word or a phrase in a song. Maybe it's something simple that we need to see God. What do you need? You see, this story doesn't end with the disciples seeing Jesus and coming to trust him. In fact, that's just the beginning of the story. This is just the beginning. Christ has risen, and now there is work to do. Scary work that would cost them their lives. We have to remember that they are commissioned to make God visible to others through their actions and words. They were commissioned to be the Mary Magdalene. They were commissioned to say, I have seen the risen Lord. So how can you make Jesus visible to others? How do you show people as you go out into the world today to be the church that Christ loves, that Christ cares, that God is with us, that the Holy Spirit never leaves our side? Can you be what a person needs to see God? Can you write that note? Can you share that smile? Can you offer that hug? Can you share your faith and your story? Can you witness the love you feel so that other people may see God? I'm going to end on a light note. When I was an associate pastor at a fairly large church in Florida, I was young and fresh out of seminary, and of course I thought I knew everything. I still think I know everything. I'm working on it. But there was one person that came in constantly. We were inner city, and just constantly came in asking for help, like every day. And we had paid this person's bills like for months and months and months and months and months. And it felt to me as a brand new person to the ministry that that the church was starting to get used, they weren't helping themselves at all. And I was starting to feel a little jaded. And it was probably like 8 months in, and this person had literally been in my office every week for the last like 6 weeks. We had paid rent, we had paid light bill, we had found clothes for our children, and she came in with one more thing, and I was sort of abrupt with her. And one of my favorite people there pulled me aside and said to me, "Never forget that you are Jesus to the people who walk in that door." And I needed to be knocked down in that moment. I needed to be reminded that for some people, I represent the faith in which I proclaim. So every rude word I utter for them is coming out of the mouth of God. Someone called the church. They were looking for Jesus. Would my words allow them to see God in that moment when they needed it? And that's true for all of us, not just a pastor. But when you walk out of this church, you carry your Christian faith with you. It doesn't stay in this building. It doesn't sit with your Bible on a bookshelf. You carry it with you into the world. And for someone who needs it desperately, you might be the key piece to them being able to see Jesus, to feel God's love, to truly walk in the light that we know and feel every day. It's something to think about, because we all have our doubts, we all have our fears, but someone out there is asking themselves, where's God? And they just need one more person to show them. Amen.